The grand aim of science is to figure out how it all works, which includes giant questions like, where did the universe come from? What's it really made of? How does all of that stuff work and interact with each other? And how is it that human intelligence exists and is able to experience the universe and probe it with our minds? You know, small stuff like that. Ever since someone stood underneath a starry sky, looked up and went, ugh, people have been asking these questions. We can see forms of science as far back as the ancient Mesopotamians and Egyptians, but the theory of science has its roots in philosophy, with the Greek philosopher Aristotle being the first to think about how to actually go about doing science. This methodology has been refined over the ages and is now called the philosophy of science. This core of science is the scientific method, which contains principles like logic, rationalism, empiricism, evidence, testable hypotheses, objectivity, and reductionism. This is the toolkit of science and helps us process the information we get about the universe to work out what is and isn't true. Mathematics and computer science are not technically sciences because they don't study the natural world, but they're very close to science and are incredibly useful tools for scientists to use. Mathematics is the machinery of physics, and it's kind of a mystery why mathematics describes the universe so well. Computers are used in all branches of science because to do science, you need a brain, and computers are an amazing tool to augment our brains. The core of science is made of physics, chemistry, and biology, which contain a load of surrounding disciplines as well. I don't have space to include them all, but I have done in-depth maps of all of these subjects, so check out those if you want to find out more. If you take a step back and look at all of science, it's interesting to see how the scientific method changes as you apply it to different subjects. Physics made huge amounts of progress to understand the universe through reductionism, breaking things apart into their smallest components and understanding them one by one. But when you move up the chain towards chemistry and biology, reductionism becomes increasingly difficult to apply because these subjects deal with much more complex systems. If you want to study a part of biology, the properties of a single thing are strongly defined by its relationships with everything else. You can no longer study individual pieces in isolation, because removing them from their relationships actually changes the thing you want to study. So there are so many complicated relationships in things like how your genes in your DNA are expressed to make you, or how your neurons and neurochemistry all combine to create the unique experience that you're having now. These systems emerge out of a massive number of very complicated relationships. And so capturing all of that complexity in one model is incredibly hard. In fact, as we get further and further up the chain, away from physics, the entire scientific method starts breaking apart. You can see this in fields like nutrition and psychology, where incredibly important historical results are looking increasingly questionable, like eating saturated fat leading to high cholesterol, or how it's hard to replicate the results of many famous psychology studies, like willpower being a limited resource. But I think that these mistakes are understandable, because trying to come up with a scientific theory that explains why people do the things that people do is just a very hard thing to do because people are complicated. And in fact, there's an argument that the human brain is the most complex system that we know about in the universe. And so when you get a whole load of those together doing stuff, like in sociology, it just gets crazy. Which brings us to the social sciences, which I've arranged vaguely from more sciencey to less sciencey. These subjects often contain a mixture of scientific practices and practices from the humanities, like archaeology, which uses hard science techniques from physics to detect structures under the ground or carbon date objects. But then the interpretation of what this evidence tells us about the humans that lived at that time becomes a lot more subjective. Or in fields like economics or political science, where people can apply rigorous statistical techniques to their data, but then the interpretation of those has to be done by a human brain, who is, by nature, subjective. So the proof that these interpretations are not scientific is the fact that they can't predict the future. So in economics, it seems we can't predict when a recession's going to happen or what Bitcoin's going to do tomorrow. Whereas in physics, if I throw a ball, I can describe the future of that ball incredibly well. But please note that I'm not saying that subjectivity is necessarily a bad thing. If you're studying a subject matter that has these very complex systems in them, and you've taken the scientific method to its breaking point, what else are you going to do? Subjectivity really is all you have left. But the trouble comes when it's not recognized or flagged appropriately. People think they're being objective when they're actually being subjective, and that does happen. But this is forcing people to innovate with the scientific method and come up with new techniques to deal with these systems. One example from history are randomized control trials in the pharmaceutical industry to really tell whether a drug is working or not. And with the recent crisis, in replication crisis in the social sciences, scientists are now trying to come up with new techniques and methodologies to deal with these complicated systems. And it's a very hard challenge, but that's how you progress. But if you want to get at the truth of something in the world, the scientific method is still our best way of doing that. But now let's carry on our journey and leave the burden of scientific rigor behind us and move into the arts, a place of pure subjectivity. Is this good art? Well, I like it. Okay. The one thing they do share with science is exploration, pushing the limits of what has been done or thought before. They explore the human condition through books, movies, music, art, and are always trying to find new ways of reflecting on what it is to be alive and a human with emotions and a brain, with the ability to create. And I think it's just as well that we can't explain all of those things with science, because they'd lose all of their charm. That intangible nature is what makes them so much fun. Some of the most enduring art has tackled the biggest questions like, what is it to be human? Why are we here? And what should we do with our time here? These are very similar to where we started and brings us right back to the other side of philosophy. So I got a bit carried away. This map isn't really a map of science, it's a map of human endeavour. And it isn't even a map, but a giant cosmic donut of knowledge. Anyway, that's it. Thanks for watching. And if you want to get hold of the donut of knowledge, check out the link in the description below to get a poster. And if you yourself want to learn some science, I would recommend checking out the sponsor to this video, brilliant.org. It's a website where you learn a lot of the core concepts in this map, like mathematics, computer science, physics, and many more. And you learn them by answering questions. So in general, when you're learning a subject, you might feel like you know it, but there's only one way to make sure, and that's by actually answering questions to test your knowledge. That's using the scientific method on yourself. So that's what you do on brilliant.org. You learn by answering questions, but they're fun and engaging. They're very satisfying when you get one right, and if you get one wrong, there's lots of help and descriptions to help you work out why. So if that sounds interesting, check out brilliant.org/DOS. Link is also in the description below. And as an added bonus, the first 200 people to sign up can get a 20% discount off the annual premium membership, which unlocks all of their content. So check that out. And also, we've just released the next in the Professor Astrocap books, which is a space rockets book. So if you've got a youngster in your life who you'd like to get into science at a young age, they're a really good place to start. Link's also in the description below. Well, that's it for me. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next video.